knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
When watching crime-related shows or courtroom dramas, some frequent standout moments will always be the expert testimony. A scientist is called upon to testify against or in favor of the accused and is confronted with a battery of questions by both the prosecutor and the defense. In this tutorial, we will discuss this topic as the last stage of the investigation. Actually, expert testimony isn't technically the last stage of the investigation, but it acts as a full stop to all the processing the evidence has undergone to this point. This is where the evidence will genuinely influence justice. As we have learned, once the evidence gets analyzed and its results are interpreted, the forensic scientists at the laboratory have to communicate their results to the investigators, judiciary, and attorneys. The issue is that forensic scientists understand the evidence significantly better than anyone else. The scientists possess necessary expertise in this particular domain, and the same can't be said about the investigator and courtroom officials. It is due to this expertise that we consider the scientist an expert. Let us look at a quote by Sir Bernard Spilsbury, often hailed as the father of forensic science. An expert is someone knowing more and more about less and less, eventually knowing everything about nothing. From this quote, we can derive the basic function of an expert, as well as what the criminal justice system expects from them. The expert's basic function is to communicate information about the evidence in the domain of their field, but the most important requirement while doing this is that the expert must be able to convey information in the fewest words possible. The testimony would be ineffective if the expert communicates in highly complex and scientific terms, which are incomprehensible to most people, and expertise does not always translate to effective communication. When an expert testifies, it is as though they are a teacher and the people in the courtroom are their students for a moment. The expert must minimize the esoteric terminology. The testimony must be given in simple language understood by everyone. If technical terminology is avoided, it helps the judiciary and other officials to understand facts about the evidence in a clear and concise manner. So, in this context of expert testimony, who is an expert? Can only a scientist be regarded as an expert? Do all scientists automatically qualify as experts? Who decides what makes an expert and what doesn't? Let us answer these questions. But before doing that, we should rewind a bit and look upon history. Calling an expert witness to testify is a fairly ancient practice. It was documented that in ancient Babylonia, midwives were adjudged as experts to gauge a woman's virginity, fertility, and pregnancy. During the Roman Empire, midwives, handwriting experts, and land surveyors were recognized as legal experts. However, the codification of experts as witnesses, the admissibility of their testimony, and scientific evidence by formulating rules and regulations is a rather recent phenomenon in the Western judicial system for only the last 250 years. The first time an expert testified in the courtroom to offer opinion on the evidence in a similar way as we see now was in 1782. A civil engineer by the name of John Smeaton was called to give an opinion on litigation regarding silting of Wells Harbor in Norfolk. This case is considered a landmark because it helped in framing the modern rules of expert testimony, where the contextual expertise of the expert helps in judging a case. Now let us look at Rule 702 of the Federal Rules of Evidence enacted in 1975 that defines expert testimony. A. A witness who is qualified as an expert by knowledge, skill, experience, training, or education may testify in the form of an opinion or otherwise if the expert's scientific, technical, or other specialized knowledge will help the trier of fact to understand the evidence or to determine a fact in issue. B. Expert scientific testimony is admissible only if the court is satisfied that the expert testimony rests upon reliable scientific principles. From this rule, we can understand that the expert must be qualified in the topic of the testimony. To declare a person as an expert witness, according to the Federal Rules of Evidence, the court must be satisfied that the said professional has specialized education, training, or practical experience in the subject matter relating to the case. There's no mention in this rule that the expert witness should necessarily be a scientist. An expert can be anyone who's not a scientist but just a professional, a school bus driver, a door maker, a blacksmith, or even a scuba diver. The only catch here is that these professionals must be declared as an expert by the court of law. Even a forensic scientist is not an expert by default unless they are declared as such by the court. In a similar manner, even a shoemaker is an expert if they have been declared as an expert by the court. Whoever the expert may be, from a forensic scientist to a shoemaker, the testimony should be firmly based on scientific principles, as mentioned in point B of Rule 702. The expert should only offer an opinion on how the actus reus, or guilty act of the defendant, resulted or did not result in the manifestation of the evidence. They should not pass any loaded opinion towards the acquittal or conviction of the accused due to some vested interest. A court often has an independent expert, but the defense counsel or the prosecutor can still refer to a separate expert for a second opinion on the evidence. Such experts are frequently coaxed to testify in favor of the litigating party, thus making it a very stressful job for them. Sometimes, during cross-examination, lawyers do ask many uncomfortable questions of the expert, doubting their integrity, credibility, and qualification. Therefore, the expert must stay focused on the facts related to their expertise and handle the stressful questions without hampering the testimony. However, with growing experience over several cases, the expert becomes skilled in handling such situations and becomes an expert in the experience of delivering expert testimony. Lawyers often try to put the expert witness who has analyzed the evidence in a spot by interrogating about its chain of custody. Chain of custody is an important factor for ensuring the admissibility of evidence in the court. We have already discussed how evidence is processed from its recognition to laboratory analysis. And between these stages, the evidence is not in the possession of a single person, like if it gets transferred from the investigator to the laboratory. Within the laboratory, a single piece of evidence might have to be analyzed in different divisions. For example, a blood-stained revolver is collected by the investigator. They send it to the laboratory for analysis. In the laboratory, this revolver is sent to the fingerprints division, then to the biology and serology division, and at last to the ballistics division. This change in custody needs to be documented each time the evidence is transferred from one person to another. This process of documented transfer of evidence from one person to another is called chain of custody. A chain of custody form contains information including the description of the evidence, the time and date of release for all prior custodians of the item, and the time and date of release to the witness. If there are any minute discrepancies in documentation, the evidence is regarded as tainted and the chain of custody declared broken, making the evidence inadmissible. Even if the evidence stays idle in the evidence room and this period is not documented in the chain of custody, it can be considered inadmissible. Therefore, the expert needs to ensure that the chain of custody is maintained so that evidence gets authenticated, proving it is the same thing that was collected from the crime scene. With the continually developing knowledge in different domains of sciences post-industrial revolution, there needed to be established certain standards on what constitutes scientific evidence and what does not. These standards were necessary because when the literature regarding a topic is not well developed, there exists a very thin line between pseudoscience and actual science. The point is that a theory becomes acceptable as science only when the scientific community accepts it. Due to the scientific and technological boom in the last few centuries, many scientific techniques were developed and utilized in crime scene investigation. However, many techniques of analysis that are well accepted by the scientific community today were rejected by the scientific community back then, citing a lack of enough research. This was when the court felt the need to put forth a standard for admissibility of evidence. In 1923, in Fry v. the United States, the results of a polygraph lie detector were admitted as evidence in the trial. Though polygraph is well accepted by the scientific community as a means to detect deception today, back then it was heavily resented. Therefore, the District of Columbia Court rejected the scientific validity of polygraph. The court wrote that, just when a scientific principle or discovery crosses the line between the experimental and demonstrable stages is difficult to define. Somewhere in this twilight zone, the evidential force of the principle must be recognized, and while the courts will go a long way in admitting experimental testimony deduced from a well-recognized scientific principle or discovery, the thing from which the deduction is made must be sufficiently established to have gained general acceptance in the particular field in which it belongs. Therefore, expert testimony must not only be based on scientific methods, but these methods should also be sufficiently established and accepted by the scientific community. This standard for admissibility of evidence came to be known as the Frye standard, or the general acceptance test. Because of this, the court can consult different subject matter experts or refer to books and research papers extensively before determining if the expert testimony meets the standard or not. The Frye standard was commonly followed by all jurisdictions for a long period, when in 1975, the Federal Rules of Evidence were enacted. As we saw earlier, Rule 702 of FRE defines expert testimony. There are two major points in this rule. One defines an expert, and the other states that the testimony should be based on reliable scientific techniques. In this rule, nothing is mentioned about the general acceptability of scientific techniques. Therefore, the courts were confused regarding how to determine if the FREs were enacted to support the Frye standard or to completely supersede it, ignoring general acceptability. To clear this confusion, the court felt the need to establish a different standard for admissibility of evidence. In Daubert v. Merrill Dow Pharmaceuticals, Incorporated, the Supreme Court held that the FRE implicitly overturned the Frye standard. The court also laid down a different standard for admissibility of evidence, which is now referred to as the Daubert standard. It provides four factors for the court to determine if the expert testimony is admissible or not: whether the expert's theory or technique can be and has been tested, whether the theory or technique has an acceptable known or potential rate of error, the existence and maintenance of standards controlling the technique's operation, whether the theory or technique has attained general acceptance. Though the Daubert standard may not seem much different than the Frye standard, the fact we must remember here is that the main issue at hand was to clarify the confusion arising from Frye and FRE, and not to form a new standard. At present, 22 states in the U.S. have adopted this standard for analyzing their own expert witness rules. With that, we have discussed everything regarding expert testimony. As mentioned before, at this stage, the processing of evidence is completed, and at this point, we have covered all the basics regarding crime investigation. It was paramount to understand all these laws and stages, as they are common to all types of evidence. Starting with the next tutorial, we will begin covering each type of evidence in detail and their individual processing. This evidence will include fingerprints, lip prints, teeth, hair, blood, semen, saliva, bones, footprints and footwear marks, soil, glass, paint, and much more. Let's move forward and get started.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.